Reprise du débat, the Honourable Member for Edmonton West.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Now, I'm going to be sharing my time today with my remarkable colleague from Cariboo Prince George. I use the word remarkable because the word incredible for him has been overused recently. Now, I'm proud to speak today on Bill C-83, which amends the Corrections and Conditional Release Act and another act. Now, this is also known as another case of Liberals putting interests of criminals ahead of everyone else with little thought put into it. Now, I realize that should not also be confused with Liberal Bill C-71 or C-75 or C-28 or any other myriad number of bills that they've put criminal rights ahead of regular citizens. Now, we all know of the horrific story of the case of Ashley Smith and her unfortunate death. Now, this never should have happened within our prison system. And the government should make moves to prevent situations like that recurring. But they should not have a poorly thought out outright ban on the segregation. Now, there are some good parts to this bill, and I congratulate the government on it. I support the idea of body scans to prevent contraband and drugs coming into prisons, but I think it should be extended to everyone entering the prison, not just certain people. And I also like that they're considering better considerations for Indigenous offenders. But, and it's a big but, there's a few key points in this bill that would directly impact the safety and security of our corrections officers and those who need segregation for their own safety. This is another example of the government's obsession with putting making criminals' lives easier while making our frontline officers' jobs more dangerous. I want to talk about the reality of the most common use of segregation. Inmates that commit the crimes in prison don't always get the segregation. It's very often the victims get segregated to protect them from those inmates. It's often used as a means of ensuring the safety of a targeted inmate from further assault, often because the target doesn't want to name who assaulted them. This means the assaults continue, then the inmate who went into a segregation unit has to eventually reintegrate somewhere else on another unit or in another institution or even another region in the country. It's relatively uncommon that segregation is ordered as a disciplinary sanction. In fact, most inmates view segregation time as a holiday rather than a consequence, especially since they must receive all their possessions and their property card within 24 hours of admission, such as their television and their other belongings. A report from CBC that came out past April quoted the Ontario Public Service Employees Union saying, "Segregation isn't the deterrent it once was because maximum time inmates can spend in segregation has been halved, and increased privileges for those in segregation mean that inmates are no longer skittish about being sent there." He also confirmed that, in fact, there aren't enough segregation units, at least in Ontario, because most are being used by inmates who have mental health issues. Now, that's a provincial system, but it correlates to the federal system as well. That leaves violent inmates out in the general population where they can continue to commit assaults against other inmates and correction officers themselves. An officer said, "Where the most violent inmates used to be in separate containers, now they're all off in one bag, and we're just waiting for one to go off. And that sets off the rest of them, and you end up with murder, stabbing, slashing, and officer injuries higher than ever." Another officer stated, "The inmates, they can get away with a lot more than they used to in the past, and that contributes to the growing violence and crisis in corrections." Now, with previous changes to segregation policies, the maximum time segregation has already been cut in half, as I mentioned. And the increase in privileges available to those in segregation means it's not as strong as a deterrent as it used to be. All removing segregation does, especially for disciplinary segregation, is soften reprisals for bad behavior. Inmates know that there's one less tool for correction officers to use to maintain order and ensure the safety of the officers themselves and other inmates. CBC report from last year indicated stricter limits on segregation have led to a massive upswing in inmate assaults. Between 2012 and 2017, the number of violent reoffense after leaving segregation has increased 50%. Ontario recently released stats for corrections. There was almost 800 reported incidents in 2016. By halfway through 2017, the last time we had the numbers available, there was almost as many violent incidents in our prisons. The report quotes Jason Godin, who's the president of the Union of Correctional Officers, who says segregation is a tool for reasons that restrictive policies only transfer the problems of the violence. The creation and integration of structured intervention units, the SIUs, makes inmates, violent and nonviolent, equal regardless of the quantity of their quality of their conduct while they serve their time. They get access to 4 hours per day outside their cells from the structured units, and they also get 2 hours of significant human contact, it's also going to require significant increase in resources from the officers. But there's no money set aside for this. Now, every time someone's moved into segregation or segregation out for their 2 hours out in the open, it requires two officers to accompany them. That is for the safeties of the officers to ensure that they always have enough manpower to protect themselves. Where is this money going to come from? Well, if you look at the government's departmental plans signed by the Minister of Public Safety, they're actually cutting, including inflation, 8.8% of the funding to Corrections Canada over the next 4 years. So where is this money coming from? They're actually, if you look at the departmental plan, and I'm sure the minister didn't even look at it before he signed off on it, and I'm sure my colleagues across the way haven't read the plans either, because it actually calls for a reduction in officers in Corrections Canada over the next years. But they're going to increase
the workload.
They're going to increase the cost of these units with what money? We don't know. The officers themselves are left with one less tool that allows them to deter assaults and violence from taking place in the cell blocks. Corrections officers always face a host of challenges. Now, keep in mind, these men and women, even though it's their choice to work in these jobs, they are still in a prison themselves. They're subjected to the same environment that the inmates are. Now, I'm going to read out stats from 2018 report prepared by the Union of Correctional Officers. Between 60 and 65% of correctional officers report that their work has a negative impact on their life away from work. Substantial proportion of correction officers, about 75%, report that psychological demands on their jobs have increased in the last 5 years. 55% of long service officers report that the physical ability to properly do their work is worse or much worse than the last few years. The report summarizes there's a particular poor fit between interest in work and the psychological and mental disposition of the officers, and the environment and working conditions set out maintained by Corrections Canada on the other. Such a poor fit cannot go on forever nor be ignored other than to the detriment of both the correctional officers as well as the public interest as embodied in CSC's mandate and social mission. I want to look at another area the government has failed a corrections officer. They're one of the main victims of the Liberal Phoenix fiasco. Roughly 85% of the correction services officers across the country have been affected by Phoenix. This is because many of correction services officers are shift workers with irregular schedules that require manual entry into the system, something this government could have prevented had they not botched the entire rollout. Now, in fact, the Treasury Board was specifically told of this specific failure in the Phoenix system when they were doing the pre-testing, yet they chose to ignore it. Just like the president of the Treasury Board ignored the Gartner report when it advised him not to proceed with Phoenix. Now, I find it very amusing that the president of the Treasury Board justifies his meddling in the Davies supply ship contract on behalf of Irving as part of his job. But not part of his job, apparently, was acting on the Gartner report on Phoenix, which, by the way, the TBS president himself commissioned. Now, the UCCO president has already called on help for their members because of public servants are negotiating their mortgages, they're being forced to renegotiate their mortgages, take out loans to ensure that they keep a roof over their heads because of the pay problems. Now, fortunately, we don't see an end to sight for those suffering from the Phoenix pay system. I want to talk about the government's priorities here. Again, I mentioned before about their priorities seem to be on criminals, not on average Canadians. Last year's budget, page 210 of the budget, $24 million for mental health needs of RCMP officers. The same amount for the mental health needs of federal inmates. Now, the funny thing is, there's a lot more RCMP officers than there are inmates. So we have from this government, for the average RCMP officer, the people who are putting their lives on the line every day, the people who are fighting for us, $1,100 per officer for mental health. For prisoners, $1,400. Where's the justice? In the CSC's mandate letter, much ballyhooed, first time Correction Services lead has had a mandate letter. 1,400 word mandate letter, 24 words on victims, 52 words on the workers. And of those 52 workers, it includes such gems as, I encourage you to install within CSC a culture of ongoing reflection. There is this government's priorities in a nutshell. More money for criminals, less for the RCMP, and for our valued officers in the prisoners. Perhaps time for self-reflection on the issue. Thank you.
Here. Well done.